Hello, and welcome to the sixth of the London Digital Classicist 2020 seminars. Today, we have Claire Holleran from Exeter, who is going to talk to us about mapping migration in Roman Iberia. Quickly, before I give the floor to Claire, I just want to let you know that we have two more seminars to go. The first one of those will be in 2 weeks' time on the 7th of August, and that will be Charlotte Tupman, another Exeter person. And the last one will be Andrew Roberts, whose seminar date will be rescheduled in the next couple of weeks, and we will let you know as soon as we can. But now we have Claire, and I want first, obviously, to thank Claire for being here with us today. Gabby, who's one of our co-organizers, and the people in the chat who've joined us today, the people watching live on YouTube, and everyone who is going to watch this later on their own time. Now, for those watching live, don't forget that you can leave comments in the YouTube comment section and questions that we can later on put to Claire when we go to the discussion session of today's seminar. Now I give the floor to Claire.
Thank you. So what I'm going to talk about today is my current project, which is mapping migration in Roman Iberia. This is a project that was initially funded by the Leverhulme Trust for a year back in 2016. It's been a bit delayed by two periods of maternity leave and now by COVID-19. So while I'd originally intended to demonstrate the finished resource to you today, it's not quite there yet. It should, I hope, be completed in the next few months. But what I'll do today is talk you through the project and its aims and demonstrate the concept, really, rather than the finished product itself. In some ways, I guess it's a good opportunity for me because I can get feedback whilst still at this developmental stage. So if anybody does have any thoughts, that would be great to hear them afterwards. So as the title suggests, this is a project to map migration in Roman Iberia, and it's done on the basis of the epigraphic evidence. This has already been digitally catalogued on Hispania Epigraphica, which forms the basis of the data for the project. So when we find, for example, a funerary monument in Roman Pax Iulia commemorating an individual which records that they came from Roman Ilissipo or Lisbon, as we see here, then we can identify a mobile individual. So this is the epitaph of Marcus Iulius Avitus from Ilissipo, Ilissipensis. And he died age 30 in Pax Iulia, about 135 kilometers away from Ilissipo. We can't say for certain, of course, that he moved permanently to Pax Iulia, just that he died there. But what we can see is that he was a mobile individual. So the aim of this project is to draw together these inscriptions, to catalogue them and to map them. And so the idea behind that really is that it will allow us to explore the dynamics of Roman population movement in a new way. So it's exploiting old data, but visualising it differently. And hopefully through doing that, analysing it in a different way. So what I'm doing is putting together an open access digital resource, which will consist of an interactive map of population movement, and then an article based on this material, sort of interrogating the results. So the first step really is to finish this open access resource, so to finish the map. So I'd like to start today really by taking you through some of the data. So looking at some of these inscriptions and talking about the different ways in which people express their origin and what that might mean. So this is a project based on inscriptions. And as many of you may have been thinking, that does come with various limitations. So I'm going to start by going through some of the ones that, you know, I'm aware of. You might have some more to hit me with at the end. But the first limitation is that this data is, of course, subject to the usual habits of epigraphic recording and survival. So setting up an inscription to commemorate an individual's life or a vow to a god, construction of a building, whatever it is, represents a deliberate decision. It's not a universal act, particularly when we consider that these are written in Latin. So any study based on epigraphic data is inevitably a study of a self-selecting group of people who choose to write on stone. So the wealthy, the military, Freed slaves are typically overrepresented, and the poor and the illiterate are typically underrepresented. Secondly, recording an origin inscriptions is not standard practice. So maybe about 5% of all the inscriptions on Hispania Epigraphica include any sort of designation of origin. So we are very much dependent on individuals or their commemorators consciously choosing to identify their origins for whatever, you know, specific personal cultural reasons that might be. So, for example, the highest number of migrants in the data come from Clunia. Now, that might mean that Clunians were more mobile than those from other cities. And that certainly has been argued that, you know, there was some sort of economic issue in Clunia, which meant that people moved. But it could also be that Clunians were just more likely to tell you that they were from Clunia. They were more likely, for whatever reason, to record their origin. Thirdly, it is difficult to distinguish between mobility and migration as such. So funerary monuments such as this one, they just tell us that a person died in a particular place. We don't know if Iulius Avitus was there temporarily, if this was a stop on a longer journey that he was taking, or if he had actually migrated permanently to that location. And finally, very few of these inscriptions can be dated with any precision. So that does make it difficult to detect changing patterns in movement across time or to link migration to any particular historical event. All that said, I think the epigraphic data here is rich and it is informative about population movement. We've got over 550 migrants so far in the sample. Now, most of them express their origin in the same way as Marcus Iulius Avitus here. So they have an ethnic adjective after their name. So it typically follows the cognomen and is in the same case as the name. So that's what we see here. We've got Marcus Iulius Avitus Alisipenensis. So Marcus Iulius Avitus of Alisipo. So it's the adjectival form of the city of Alisipo. Another example here, this is Gaius Camillius Paternus of the Galeria tribe of Clunia. So Cluniensis is how he describes himself. So again, we've got the cognomen and we've got this ethnic adjective that follows after it. He's 25 years old and he dies in Capra. Now the rest of this inscription is quite interesting. It talks about this Vicinia Cluniensium. Now the reading of that is disputed. Some people have read it as a name, so Vicinia, a slave of Clunia. The more common reading is that this is a neighbourhood association of Clunians. So Vicinia here being a kind of neighbourhood. If that's correct, then we have here a local association who may have facilitated migration from Clunia to this region. So this is found in Capra, as I said, and we do actually have a cluster of 8 recorded individuals from Clunia in Capra. Now, we don't know the dates of all of those, so we don't know if they're there at the same time. But certainly the fact that we get this cluster is, I think, interesting. And that Vicinia Cluniensia may be connected to that. So most commonly, we've got this true nomina with an ethnic adjective after the cognomen. But it's not always a true nomina. So sometimes it's just a single name with an ethnic adjective, as we have here with Lupus of Iminium. So Lupus Iminiensis. And he's commemorated by his brother. It might not mean his literal brother, but Quintus Iulius Rufinus. And he's found in Iminium. Sorry, he's from Iminium and he's commemorated at Emerita Augusta in Lusitania. One issue here is that there is a bit of a crossover between these ethnic adjectives and ethnically derived names. So sometimes what looks like an ethnic adjective, so it's identical in form, appears as part of somebody's name. So typically where we would expect a cognomen. So that's what we see in these two examples here. I couldn't find any images of these, unfortunately, but this is Marcus Licinius Belliensis. So it's exactly the same in form as an ethnic adjective, but because we find it after a gentilicium, where we would typically expect a cognomen, I mean, it's not a hard and fast rule, but no, it's what we would expect to see. These have been treated as names rather than ethnic adjectives. So it could indicate a link to Vallea, which is 435 kilometres away from where this dedication was made. but it's a bit less certain. So the geographic significance of this is a bit less certain. And that's the same here with Antistius Patriciensis. So he could be talking about his origin in Patricia Colonna, which is Cordoba, but we are less certain. And for that reason, there is a filter on the map, on the final version of the map, where you can filter out less certain examples of movements, such as those which are from onomastics, from names. There are some other ways of denoting origin, and some of those are also a little bit problematic. So, for example, we have the use of the term natio, and that can be used to demonstrate a link to a particular peoples, a particular city, or sometimes just to a specific geographic region. So in this example here, this is a fragmentary inscription. So it's an anonymous gladiator, an Oplomachus, who describes himself as being, or is described by his wife, as being of the people of the Bessi. So Natione Bessus. So from the Bessi in Thrace, having come over to Spain. Here we get it used to refer to somebody from a particular city. So Natione Nicomedica, Mulia Glycinus. So this from the people of Nicomedia. And again, she's moved over 3,000 miles from Nicomedia to Spain. But sometimes it is just used to refer to a broader geographical region or province, and that's a little bit more problematic. So we have here another gladiator who is described as being of the people of Germania, so Nortione Germanus. So is Probus here being described as of Germanic descent, so from the German peoples, or is he from the province of Germania, either inferior or superior? Now, is this a geographic or an ethnic designation, or is it both? So examples like this are mapped to a representative point. So Probus is mapped to a representative point in Germania, but obviously there is quite a margin of error here. And while this inscription does testify to some sort of human mobility, the details are a little bit sketchy. There are notes attached to this sort of inscription, which are noting all these ambiguities, but there is that danger, I think, that when something is mapped or tabulated, it makes what is essentially an interpretation look a lot more concrete than it's intended. I think that becomes particularly clear when we look at this final example here. This is, I think, the latest inscription in the database. So it's late 4th century. And in terms of mobility and ethnicity, this is a really complicated inscription. So it was found in Tarragona, and it relates to Aurelius Aeliodorus, of the people of Greece, so Natione Graeca. He's a citizen of Tarsus, spends some time in Seville, Hispalis, lived 80 years and is commemorated in Tarragona. He's mapped as moving from Tarsus to Tarragona, but obviously it's much more complicated than this. There are some other ways in which people denote their origin. Sometimes we get domo in conjunction with a place name, which roughly translates as with his or her home at. We get the use of the preposition ex, so out of or from, and then a place. We get the Latin term origo plus a place name. We get oriundus sometimes, sort of meaning originating in or springing from. Sometimes we just get a place name. And on a couple of occasions, we get verna, which is usually a term that denotes a slave born in a master's household, but it can be used to say where somebody is from as well. So we do get some other examples, but they're rare. There's just a handful of those examples. In the vast majority of cases, origin is expressed by an ethnic adjective, and interpreting that origin is relatively unproblematic. So when a person claims a link to one place but is epigraphically attested elsewhere, we can be fairly certain that we're looking at population movement. But because there are some ambiguities in this material, you can filter by type of origin in the map. So what I've done is catalogued all of these inscriptions, initially just in an Excel database. So for each inscription, I've recorded the following information. So as regards the inscription, there are all the references. So its number on Hispania Epigraphica, whether it's got a CIL reference, whether it's on the Heidelberg database, and so on. We've got the monument type. So is it a stele or an altar, a statue base? The kind of inscription, So is it an epitaph? Is it an honorific? Is it a votive? And so on. The date, when known, and probably only about a quarter of these can be dated, if that. The text of the inscription, so essentially an addition. I've done an addition for all of these. A translation, because I want this to be accessible. All of these inscriptions have been translated, most of them for the first time. And then where necessary, an apparatus and commentary. And all of these are now in EpiDoc. So with the help of my wonderful colleague, Charlotte Tupman, these have all been put into EpiDoc. So I have now learnt to, finally, have learnt to use EpiDoc. As regards the migrant themselves, the following information is recorded. So their name, their age, their sex, their legal status, their voting tribe, their profession, if there is one on the inscription, whether or not they hold an administrative or religious office, what their social rank is, and the method of denoting origin, which is what I've just been talking about there. And finally, the geographic data. So the geographic data is taken primarily from Pleiades, which in turn is based mainly on the Barrington Atlas of the Greek and Roman world. So all the origins for ancient places are linked to Pleiades, as are find spots of the inscriptions if they're from an ancient place. Geonames is used for modern places that don't have a known corresponding ancient place. So all of that data has then been fed into an online database and map by my colleagues in digital humanities at Exeter, so by Charlotte Tupman and Richard Holding. So it's still in the process of development, so it's only accessible on the University of Exeter server at the moment. So that's one of the reasons why I can't do a live demonstration of it for you from home. Because of homeworking, I can't access a lot of the material at the moment, but I can show you some of the functionality and how it works. This is a bit low tech because it's all done with screen grabs based on what I could get hold of, really. But I think it does give you some indication of the functionality. So this is what it looks like at the moment. We just hone in on the map itself. At the moment, the numbers don't really mean anything. There's 418 on here, but this data is all very much out of date. So there will be over 550 eventually when it's completed. The orange and the green circles represent places of emigration and immigration. So they're heat maps, and the larger the circle, the more people left or arrived. And they're color-coded. So green places are centers of immigration. So more people came there than left, and orange ones like this one here are places of emigration. So more people left than came. There is still some troubleshooting to do here. The dots within dots shouldn't be there. These sorts of things will be ironed out, I suppose, when we can all get back into work. So this here, as an example, is Tarragona. So if you click on Tarragona, all of the journey lines then become visible. Initially, we had all of the journey lines visible when you went onto the map, but it was just a mess. You couldn't really see anything. So now you only see those journey lines when you click on a place. It draws through the information about the place from Pleiades. And then we have these overall figures for the place. So we've got a net migration of 33, and that comes from 2 departures to 1 place and 35 arrivals from 29 different places. Now you can see all of the journey lines, and the arrows indicate which direction people were going in. So most of them are coming to Tarragona, which, you know, is perhaps what we would expect. This is an administrative centre, so it's no surprise really that it is a centre of migration. Now, by necessity, those journeys are expressed as straight lines. So they're illustrative rather than a record of any actual movement. And the distance of the journeys is given in kilometres based on point to point. Obviously, this does not take into account the reality of a migrant's journey. It doesn't take into account mountain ranges or semi-desert regions or the location of river crossings or bridges or seaports. In reality, journeys must have been much longer, significantly so in some cases. So the real life journeys will have reflected the road network and the course of navigable rivers and coastal routes. And so on. The major riverine routes are on here, and you can turn on the road network, as I'll show you later, but by necessity, the journeys really are just expressed as straight lines. Of course, the journeys may not all have been made in one go either, if we think of general mobility rather than migration from A to B. So you can click then on the individual journeys to see more about them. So if we choose this one here, this represents a journey from Mauritania to Tarragona. And we have a few more details about it here. So the length is 550 kilometres, and it's what we will call interprovince, so from one province to another. And we have one migrant who made that journey, and that is Saturninus, and that's his Hispania epigraphica number. So they're all linked by their HE number. So to go back to Tarragona, if we expand on departures, we can see that we've got two departures to one place, and they're both to Emerita Augusta. So we've got one anonymous migrant, and then we've got Lucius Antonius Primus, and again with their HE numbers and the distance of the journey. So we could then click on Emerita Augusta to see what kind of picture we get of migration from there. So there we've got net migration of 24. To go back to Tarragona, on the final version, you'll be able to click through and find out more about these individuals. So if we choose Lucius Antonius Primus, he will then be linked to a people page, which has details about the sex, legal status, profession. So in this case, we know he's a soldier. And he also held a military office, so he was a cornican, which is a sort of junior officer. He departed from Tarragona, from Tarraco, went to Augusta Emerita, and this is the text associated with him. So you'll be able to click through the text, and this is where you get the addition, the apparatus. So in this instance, line four, Lani Epigraphique, omit CE. And HD will be EDH, it's the Heidelberg database. These will all be changed to EDH, which is a more normal abbreviation here. But Heidelberg database suggests that there was an additional lost line at the end. So translation to Lucius Antonius Primus, bugler of Tarraco. And there's a question mark here. Why is there a question mark? Well, if you look in the commentary, origin here is here taken to be Tarraco as a city, but it could refer more generally to the province of Tarraconensis. So there is that ambiguity with the terminology here. And over on this side, you can see details of the bibliography, the object type is undefined in this case, the modern find spot, the ancient find spot, and what conventus and province we're looking at. So if we go back to Tarragona, we can then look at the arrivals picture. So we've got 35 arrivals from 29 places. So this is clearly a big centre of immigration. So again, we can look at some of the migrants. So we choose Lucius Caecilius Porcianus. Again, we've got sex male, legal status freeborn, and he held an administrative office as a duumvir. The details of the places again over here. Now you can click on each place to find out more. So if you think, oh, how many other migrants do we have from Africa? You can click through and we can see the details of the place, the Pleiades reference, texts associated with it, and people associated with it. So alongside Lucius Caecilius Porcianus, we also have another migrant, Aurelius Iulianus. And you would be able to click through and find out more details about that also. And then here are the inscription details. So again, the addition, there's no apparatus or commentary here because there's no need for one. So Lucius Caecilius Porcianus from the province of Africa, elected decurion. In addition, he's an aedile. So actually that's missing from his people file. So there is some sort of troubleshooting that needs to be done here. This place having been given by decree of the decurions. So if we look now at a centre of emigration, this is Clunia, which is the biggest centre of emigration on the map. So we've got net migration of 39. So we've got 42 departures to 24 places and three arrivals from three places. They can see here that there is a tendency for people to move towards the southwest. I mean, they are going elsewhere, but there's a big concentration of people moving in this direction. And the thicker the line, the more people took that journey. So the thicker the arrow, the more people taking it. So we can also see that some groups of individuals are going on the same journey here. So there's a real movement towards the southwest, which we can see once we put this on a map. And what is, I think, particularly interesting about Clunia is that you do get these clusters of migrants. So as I mentioned before, you've got these eight in Capra. So we looked at Gaius Camillus Paternus earlier. So perhaps we are looking at some sort of chain migration here, maybe some organised labour contractors even. If we think again about that neighbourhood association of Clunians, if they're not facilitating migration, well, they may be helping migrants when they arrive. So helping them find work or housing or contacts or whatever. So that's a quick tour of some of the basic functions of the map. You may have noticed these tabs here at the top as well. So you can get information about texts, people and places in this way as well, rather than just through the map. So there is a text page where they're in alphabetical order, or roughly in alphabetical order. There's a people page, again, in alphabetical order, and there's places. So you've got all the places together, and then ancient and modern. But as this is a mapping project, it's through the map that the data can be filtered. So searching is done through the map. And the filters, in a sense, relate to the original research questions that I had for the project, which is what I'll demonstrate at the end of this. So these are the filters. You can filter by sex, so you can look for male or female migrants. You can filter by age at death. And this is done by range, so you can do from 0 to 9 to 100 to 109. And improbably there are actually two migrants within that category. You can look by voting tribe, so for citizens. You can look by legal status. And that terminology might need a bit of a rethink. Einamic isn't a legal status as such, it's an epigraphic term for people who have single names. So it's a German term, meaning having one name. They might be slaves, they might also be freeborn, but it might make more sense to kind of conflate that category with the uncertain category, because it is just, you know, we don't know what their legal status was. We have freeborn, and that is indicated in this corpus by the presence of filiation, so by the inclusion of a father's name, the mention of a father or a mother in the inscription. Those who held roles in local administration are also designated as freeborn, apart from Augustales, and also soldiers, because being freeborn was a prerequisite for service in the Roman army. Freed and slave. So freed people and enslaved people are only designated as such when they are clearly designated, so with the term servus or libertus. And finally, this category of uncertain. So it's those might be freed, might be freeborn. So for example, sometimes we get the tria nomina, but we don't get any filiation, so we don't know what their status was. Social rank, again, terminology is a little bit problematic there, but that's just to record at the moment decurions and equestrians and everybody else. So there's no senators so far in this sample. Also by profession, most people don't have a profession on here, and most of these examples we just have one, maybe two. We have quite a few gladiators and we have about 40 soldiers. Otherwise, I think we've got one hairdresser, I think there's two architects. But profession isn't recorded all that often, but it is there as a filter. Administrative or religious office. Initially, I had all these listed as separate offices, so the duumvir, aediles, provincial priest or priestess, and so on. But there was so much overlap between individuals holding those posts, and also there was a difficulty of terminology, particularly as regards the priesthoods. So it was simplified, and it's just a case of you can search for everybody, people who do hold an administrative or religious office and people who don't. And finally, the different ways of noting origin. There actually are, in the latest version of the map, there's not going to be as many of these. So there might be about 10. Some of them have gone by the wayside for various reasons. You know, that is there because some examples are more robust than others. So onomastic examples, the geographic significance isn't as certain. So to make sure that the data is robust, you can filter that way if you wish. So for the final part of this paper, I just want to think a little bit about how I hope to use this resource, the kind of research questions that I came to the project with initially. So The article that I want to write will interrogate the data generated by the database to explore a series of research questions, and they're grouped around three main themes. So firstly, the extent of the population movement, secondly, patterns of population movement, and third, the motivation for population movement. So to start with the extent of population movement, the first question, fairly straightforward, what distances were people moving? Now that can be seen by all the individual journeys on the map. The next step, I think, is to add some functionality that allows a comprehensive table of journeys to be generated so that they can be compared. What I can say at this stage is that most journeys are over 100 kilometres. Some are thousands of kilometres, so people were moving significant distances. Was movement largely intra or inter-regional? So are people largely moving within a province? Or are they moving between provinces or between regions? Now you can see at a glance, just looking at the map, that most of the movement was within the Iberian Peninsula. But we can look at whether people were moving between provinces. So was that a barrier or not? And quite clearly, it isn't a barrier within Iberia. So what we can do is turn on the province layer. So there's a little toggle up here. You can turn on provinces. And this, the provincial boundaries are taken from Pleiades. And then if you click on a province, you can look globally at what kind of migration, what picture of migration we get in that province. So this is Lusitania. So Iberia was divided into these three provinces by, in the Augustan period. So we're looking here at Lusitania. At the top, you can see the global figures for the province. It's not people who've left, it's people who've come in. So we've got 149 migrants in Lusitania, and they're in 57 places. 58 of them are moving within the province, 91 are coming from outside the province. And then listed here, you've got all of the places that they came, that they went to, and you've got the names, and you've got their origin and the details, and of course their HE numbers, so you can click through on all of these individual migrants. Now you can also do this at the conventus level. So Richard Holding did some amazing work on this. He traced these boundaries from a map in Alfaldi. But as you can see, the boundaries are a bit fuzzy and some of the places span the boundaries. So this is illustrative, I suppose, rather than definitive. I mean, we can never quite know what these boundaries looked like. But here we've got, again, the global figures. So we've got 107 migrants within that conventus in 28 places. 40 came from within the province of Lusitania, 67 came from outside. And then the final one within this section, how much movement was there outside of the spheres of the military and government administration? So was most migration state-sponsored or forced? So are most people moving slaves? Does the epigraphic record indicate more widespread voluntary migration? This is fairly straightforward to answer, at least as regards recorded migration. So looking at what we have in this sample. So we can filter by soldiers, and that gives us 40 soldiers. Now, as I said, there is more data to go into this. So there'll be over 550 eventually. But proportionally, I don't think the number of soldiers will go up significantly. So we have, you know, a significant number of soldiers, but actually they're very much in a minority. What we can also do is turn on the military sites. So you can see here there's a little toggle to turn on the military sites, and that's the two sites here. So you've got Lyon here, which is home to the 7th Legion Gemina, and then you've got here Petivonium, which was home to the 10th Legion, who then left in the 60s and it became a cavalry unit. So what we can see is that most of our soldiers are actually found outside of those two major military settlements. Partly that's because a lot of them are veteran soldiers who just retired elsewhere. But some of them, you know, we've got this group in Tarragona. Presumably they are there on secondment to the governor, so they're there for administrative reasons. And you see that in other urban centres around Iberia. We can also turn on the administrative or religious office filter. So if we say yes, we've got 26. I think that number will be a bit higher, but probably no more than sort of 50 in the final count. So again, yes, we do have people of that social level moving around, but actually most people are not. So most people moving are not soldiers, they're not administrators. You can also filter by legal status. So out of the total migrants of 418, which we've got there at the moment, we've only got four slaves. Now, obviously that doesn't mean that slaves are not moving around. It means that slaves are not recorded as moving around, but they are only a very small number here. And we've only got 20 freed slaves. We have 18 who, you know, single names, could be slaves, don't know. We've got 160 who are uncertain. We've got 210 who are definitely freeborn. So the majority, only just, but the majority are certain freeborn. So I think what we can say is we've got lots of voluntary migration. We've got lots of migration taking place outside of, you know, the more obvious spheres of soldiers and government administrators. To move on to the second area of research, patterns of population movement. So does the map indicate chain migration or the group movement of peoples? Well, we've seen Clunia. Now, Clunia is the biggest example of that, really. Most of the other journeys are single migrants or at the most two or three. And as they're largely not datable, it doesn't tell us all that much. But I think the example of Clunians is interesting. Even if Clunians are just more likely to document their origins, the picture that we get from Clunia, this slightly fuller picture, is, I think, noteworthy, as is that association of Clunians. And we do have other associations of peoples, potentially migrants, in Iberia. So we have, we know about a Sodalicium Bracarorum in Pax Iulia, so an association of people from Bracara Augusta. So they make a dedication to Deus Invictus sometime in the second century, so to Mithras perhaps. If we look at the map, actually, we don't have any recorded migration from Bracara Augusta to Pax Iulia, which is down here. What we do have is a soldier who goes the other way. So we've got a soldier who goes from Pax Iulia to Bracara Augusta, and that's this guy here, Marcus Antonius Augustanus. And then we also have this guy, Ladronus here, who moves from Bracara Augusta down to the mines here, which is relatively close to Pax Iulia. So potentially we might have some links between those two regions, and this Sodalicium may be part of that. I mean, these two inscriptions relating to the migrants of first century, this is second century, so we've got to be aware of that dating issue there. But, you know, perhaps there are some links there, some potential for chain migration, and perhaps helped by an organization such as this Sodalicium. Oh, there's the two examples there. You've got the soldier and Ladronus. The next question, what impact might transport infrastructure have had on patterns of movement? Does most movement appear to be linked to major road or river networks? Is it more common in coastal regions? That's actually difficult. I mean, it's one of the things I would really hope would be visible with a map, but it's not actually all that clear unless you put all of the journeys on. And then because there's so many journeys, it makes it unclear again. What we can do is turn on this detailed road network for Iberia. So this little toggle here, this data for the road network was very kindly provided by Pau de Sota. And this is where I think the heat spots are actually quite useful, because we can see that most of these big centres of migration, be it immigration or emigration, are at nodes on the road network. But, you know, that's pretty much what we would expect. It's not exactly groundbreaking. It's a bit disappointing. Perhaps there is more to be done here on the micro level. This is something I'm still certainly thinking about. So if anybody's got any thoughts on how to get further with this data, that would be really, really helpful. And finally here, how far does the paradigm of the single adult male migrant hold for Roman Iberia? Can we detect any female or family migration in the epigraphic record? Well, for the second part, yes, we can. So if we think about, again, we've got this total migrant figure of 418 at the moment. We've got 80 women within that. And we have got some children. So we've got 10 who are recorded as dying under the age of 9 and 28 between the ages of 10 and 19. So men and adults dominate. I mean, they're far more likely to appear in the epigraphic record anyway, for cultural reasons. But I think it is clear that female migration was certainly not unusual, and that children do seem to have been moving also. Now, some women are commemorated by their husbands, others are commemorated by female family members or kin. A number of them, such as Licinia Materna here, are not commemorated by any named individual. Now, Licinia Materna, daughter of Paternus of Nova Augusta, 30 years old. She moved from Nova Augusta to the mines at Rio Tinto, and she died there when she was 30. So she moved over 560 kilometres. Now, the fact that she's not commemorated by any named individual doesn't necessarily mean anything, but it is perhaps suggestive of some single female migration. She died at the mines. I mean, this is a very nice inscription that she has here. Maybe she moved there for work. I mean, we know these are mixed communities. Most studies emphasise the restrictions on female mobility, and clearly men do dominate here, but women comprise a substantial minority of the sample. So they're almost 20% of the overall catalogue. So it's not particularly unusual to see women moving. As regards family migration, well, we do have a number of children here, and even some very young children. So Lucius Helvius Lupus of Emerita is our youngest child. He's 8 months old. And again, he died at Rio Tinto, which is about 140 kilometres from Emerita. And he's commemorated by both his parents. So his mother, Helvia Secundilla, and his father, Probus, had this made. And again, some very nice lettering on this inscription. The simplest explanation here is that they moved as a family when Lucius Helvius Lupus was tiny, and that he died 8 months old in Rio Tinto. The other possibility is that he was born in Rio Tinto, that he took the origin of presumably his father, which would make him a second generation migrant. But that doesn't seem to be particularly commonplace in the Iberian material. And actually, we do have some instances where a parent has an origin that their children do not. So I think that simplest explanation, that they moved as a family, may well be the correct one here. So while it might seem, you know, not what we would expect, people moving to mines as a family with small children, that might well be what's going on here. Finally, the motivation for population movement. So is it possible to suggest anything meaningful about the motivation for migration? So were there concentrations of migrants close to quarries or mines, which may indicate labour migration? Can we identify concentrations of non-military migrants close to military installations, possibly drawn by social ties or by the economic pull of the army? This is probably the area that still needs the most work. It's the reason, one of the reasons anyway, that I included the military sites on this. And actually, when we do that, we can see quite clearly that there are numerous non-military migrants in military sites. So that final question, I think we can answer positively. This question is also the main reason for including data about mines and quarries on the map. And this data comes from Oxrep. The issue really is that once you start putting on all this data, the map becomes very overcrowded and it's hard to see anything. Certainly we do have migrants in mining areas, but they're very often linked to an urban centre. So whether it's the mine or the urban centre that's brought them to that area isn't necessarily clear. There is a feature where you can click on a mine and you can look at how many migrants there are within a certain proximity. So you can go from 25 kilometres to as high as 100 kilometres, which probably isn't all that useful. But if we look at this 25 kilometre proximity, we can see that we have migrants in the vicinity of mines. This is a copper mine in sort of southwest of Iberia. We've got 7 migrants within 25 kilometres. I'm not sure how useful this informational feature is going to be at this stage of the project. I think this is one of the trickier parts to, one of the trickier questions to answer. But certainly something that I'm hoping the map will be useful for. So that's really where I am with this now. I would love to take any questions or suggestions or feedback. If it weren't for COVID, we would have had some user testing of the map by now. So in lieu of this, any thoughts would be gratefully received. I think it's also worth mentioning at this stage that while this is a standalone project in its own right, it was also intended to be a pilot study for the potential of doing this with other regions. So any thoughts on that would also be very welcome. I mean, is it possible? What do I do about Rome, I suppose, is the big issue. So yeah, any thoughts on that would also be very gratefully received. So thank you.
Thank you very much, Claire. That was brilliant. That was incredibly interesting. And I think you've driven home the point that migration is complicated. There's a surprise. So there are already a bunch of questions in the chat, but if I may start with the potential of opening another can of worms and potentially giving you another project to do. What about non-lapidary epigraphic material? That's a data question, that's a scope question. What are your thoughts?
I must admit, I haven't really thought beyond the lapidary material at the moment. I mean, what sort of things were you thinking of there?
Accounts on pots, that kind of thing, ingots, stamps of merchants, potentially, depending obviously on the records available for that sort of thing, because instrumenta I'm finding of all ends of the empire is not catalogued evenly throughout the province. Mm-hmm. It could be problematic depending on the region you're looking at, but just as a thought of potentially things extant from people who did not put inscriptions. It's great.
I certainly did initially think about these broader things. I mean, as a standalone project, this was always linked to the Hispania Epigraphica data and what was there. I did think about the potential of broader things, and maybe even as people develop better ways of looking at, you know, isotope analysis and all those kind of things, are there ways of adding all that kind of data onto it? And possibly, I mean, it is something for the future to think about whether there are ways of adding that. I think the issue, as you mentioned, of different methods of recording, how it's better catalogued in some regions than others, might be problematic. But it's certainly, yeah, something to think about with the potential of a future stage or a future development. Absolutely. Thank you.
Thank you. Shall we start with questions from the call? And then I have a long list of questions from the chat ready to go. Remember to unmute yourself. Gabby?
Yeah, thanks very much. That's there's a lot going on there. Clearly a very exciting project, and obviously frustrating that it's being delayed at the moment by circumstances. But I was struck by the potential for quantitative questions that you can ask with this data. And obviously it's a relatively small data set for that sort of thing. But I wondered if you had any initial sense from looking at your data and the way it's you know, it can be tabulated and so forth, about whether there's anything you can say about the distribution of different kinds, different sort of distances or difficulties of migration, or you know, transprovinciality or otherwise, et cetera, between the different demographic groups you're talking about. So different professions, different status, free versus slave, sex, age, those sorts of things. Do you know the women you know of, have they traveled further than the men or less far? Any patterns like that can be seen yet?
No, and I have looked for some. I mean, statistically, you know, it is a small data set, as you say. I mean, in terms of distances that women move, that was one of the things that I do remember looking at, and it's comparable to the men. There's nothing really that stands out as being unusual for any particular group within there. Even in terms of, you know, soldiers, they don't move necessarily further than anybody else, neither do administrators. So there isn't, so far I've not spotted any patterns like that, and I have looked for them with the data that I have. So not yet would be the answer. I mean, I'm slightly aware of doing statistics anyway on the basis of what I have, because, you know, as I say, we've got four slaves, but there's no way there's only four slaves moving around. It's just they're not recorded as doing so. So, I mean, one of the worries I have actually about doing this kind of project, as I mentioned, is that once you put something on a map or on a table, it makes it look definitive in a way that I don't want it to be. And I'm hoping that people will read all the ambiguities, but I don't know that they will. So yeah, that's something that I do worry about, that does trouble me.
Yeah, clearly you'd be thinking more in terms of looking at finding patterns and then trying to explain them rather than saying, I've discovered this statistic. And the fact that there aren't those differences is already new information, because you know, one could hypothesize that women would travel less far than men in, on average, and you're disproving that hypothesis. So that's
really useful. Yeah, and I was expecting to find more military movement. I was expecting to find more administrative movement. The fact that the vast majority aren't soldiers or administrators, I think, is actually quite interesting.
Any immediate questions from the call, or shall I move on to the chat? Peter? Unmute yourself.
Yes. Am I clear? Can you hear me clearly? I was wondering how you identified all the origo of all these people in the Hispania Epigraphica online, because they have about, well, I can't say exactly, 30,818 inscriptions. Did you go through them one by one, or?
No, so there is a search function on there.
Yeah.
So you can do a search by origo, which gets you to maybe two thirds of the ones that I have. So the search function is a little bit idiosyncratic on there. And then I have gone through publications essentially to find other ones, and then checked whether they are on the Hispania Epigraphica. So that is one of the limitations of the data, is that I've only included things that I can find on Hispania Epigraphica. So there may be more to add to that. So as the wonderfully patient Charlotte Tupman will say, I presented her with about 300 inscriptions, and I was like, oh, hang on, I've got more. Oh, hang on, I've got more, as I went through the data. So I kept finding more that weren't visible through the search filter on Hispania Epigraphica. Yeah,
because I was thinking about what you're saying, going beyond the Iberian Peninsula, and I was aware of this search function in Hispania Epigraphica, which seems to be still being complemented. At this time it's 535, but there might be some duplicates in there as well. Which brings me to, if I'm allowed, second question.
You're allowed.
We are aware of the fact that from our own research in the same data set, that some of these locations are not exact. So many of the inscriptions are attested to specific, I'm thinking about the mines. So in the data set, they are stated to be related to a specific city, but then when you actually check the original records, they are not at a city, but they are possibly at mines. I'm not sure, but they might be actually at the mines rather than the cities mentioned.
Yes. So I haven't been through all 550 to double check that data. I have found discrepancies when looking at it between Hispania Epigraphica and the Heidelberg database, or, you know, with Lani Epigraphic. So some of them are mapped differently to the ones in Hispania Epigraphica, but there will be a margin of error. Some of them will be not exactly where they say they are. That is an issue. Yeah. I mean, in many cases, the distances are so large that it doesn't make a huge difference, but it does if you're thinking of analysing why they've moved. So if they're at a city rather than the mine, but actually they are at a mine, it's just that they've been mapped to the nearest city.
Yeah, absolutely.
That does make a big difference. And that was one of the reasons, because I came to this originally. So normally I work on Roman economics, and I was asked to write a paper on labour mobility. And I started looking at these inscriptions, thinking about people moving to mines. And that's when I realised there was all this information there that was quite interesting about migration. And that really is why that 25-kilometer filter was on there, because I couldn't necessarily pinpoint an inscription to a mine, but I could see that people were in that region. And very often there was no other reason why they would be there, because there's nothing else there apart from lots of mines. And so, you know, I did people within a particular radius or in a mining region. So that's why the idea of doing that 25 or 50-kilometer filter came in. Whether it fits exactly with this project, whether I'm still thinking about the previous project, is, you know, something to think about. But yeah, that's absolutely something to think about. Thank you.
Thank you.
All right. We have a good number of questions in the chat, so let's start going through them now. Charlotte is asking, it would be interesting to examine which professions choose Nazione, call for a gladiator to be from the Bessi and the man from Tarsus perhaps thought Greek. What do you think there?
It does seem to be particularly common to say, to use Natio amongst gladiators, actually. So I can't remember offhand how many gladiators there are, maybe about 15, but quite a lot of them do use Natio. So it does seem to be particularly common amongst them. I hadn't really thought about the idea of the man from Tarsus teaching Greek, but that's quite interesting as well. I mean, it's difficult to know exactly what people mean by these. Whether it is just showing some sort of ethnic link with the region, or whether they're actually from there, which again is why I have that filter on the map. But yes, we do see it particularly amongst gladiators.
Interesting. And Charlotte again asking, your items like the migrant in your epidot markup?
No, they're in, so there's different files. So there's the data about the inscription in Epidoc, and then there are people files, and it's in the people files.
Mm-hmm. Right. Now we go to a more technical question. We have Cynthia asking, can you talk more about the platform and technology used? For example, can you combine filters? How did you implement the arrows and directions to the use ArcGIS Pro? Where is the database hosted?
I can't, because I didn't do any of this. This was done, I passed the data over to my colleague, Richard Holding in Digital Humanities, who went and did all of this. So I don't know exactly what platform he used. The database is hosted at the moment on the test server at the University of Exeter. It'll be made publicly available probably in the next few months when it's completed.
Yeah, I assume after the COVID extension.
Yes, that. Yeah.
Yes. And another question, which base map did you use?
Again, you'd have to ask Richard Holding. We did discuss it, but it was back in 2016, and I can't remember off the top of my head which map we went for in the end.
Next one, going through these quickly because I'm aware that it's getting late in some countries already. Kay is asking, do you compare your digital map with ancient maps? For example, the tablet on Tingeriana and travel guides to see if the movement you identify corresponds to post-classical
ideas. Not yet. So I have thought about it, and I've got the itineraries for Iberia photocopied and ready to check against it, but I haven't yet done it. But it is interesting to think about, I'm thinking of this. I mean, this map is a modern way of looking at space, but of course, in antiquity, space was thought of in a very different way, with those kind of itineraries and so on. So I think that is certainly something that would be interesting. And thinking about, journeys and how people moved, that would certainly be one way to get at it. Yes, thank you.
And you partially already replied to this, but just to make it clear what you're planning for the future, Journey's asking, first, why did you choose Hispania for the initial step? And second, do you plan to expand to other regions?
So, as I say, I chose Hispania almost by a fluke because I just started doing this project on labour migration. And it just so happened that there was all this material suggesting people moving to mines in Iberia. My impression is that it seems a bit more common in Iberia to include your origin in these inscriptions, but I don't know, because I haven't looked extensively at other regions, but there is the potential to do that. And that is certainly when I got the funding from Leverhulme, this was intended as a pilot project to see, to check the functionality, to see if it was possible to do this and potentially expand it to other regions. In some ways that depends on the documentation. I mean, Hispania Epigraphica made it easy to choose Hispania as a case study. I don't know about the other regions and whether it would be that easy. Italy, of course, is complicated by the fact that Rome and the epigraphic record from Rome is so big that that's going to cause issues, and whether it's possible, I don't know. But certainly it's something I'm interested in doing and thinking about.
I'm looking forward to this. We have Charlotte again asking, what you learned specifically from seeing the data on a map that wouldn't be clear in another way?
I mean, I haven't seen all the data on the map as yet. I think visualizing it in that way does help you see patterns of movement. So, for example, when you look at somewhere like Clunia, you can see that we do have that group of people going down to the southwest. I think you can see quite clearly the connections between North Africa and Spain. I mean, you could see this through, you know, manually looking at the Excel database as well, but I think it becomes much clearer when you look at it on a map and you can think about movements in that way. Because the map isn't finished and all the data is not on it, and you know, I haven't really been able to fully play around with it to find out what exactly we can see differently. I'm still hoping to see more, but certainly I think you can see those patterns of movement in a different way.
Mm. Yeah, making something visual makes you kind of appreciate it in a different way sometimes, that you wouldn't necessarily draw those parallels just leafing through an epigraphic corpus, just looking at indices or things.
Depending how
moving people, it's much more useful, I would say, to complement everything else you're doing by plotting it on the map. Right. You have congratulations from Joaquin.
Thank you.
Who's also asking, why do you concentrate particularly on mining as opposed to other kinds of economic activity?
I think that was in some ways a kind of hangover from the paper that I did write, looking at labour migration to mines. I think one thing about mines is that they are very often in isolated areas, so you are dependent on labour that you can move there, whether it's slave labour, whether it's convict labour, whatever. But you know, they're very rarely in areas that are already densely populated, so you do have to move labour to them. So I think they're an interesting example for that reason. But no, you're absolutely right. In none of my data set do I have a migrant who says, I'm a miner. It's only the fact that they're in that region, there's not really any other reason to be there, that I've identified them as miners. But certainly, I mean, I'm about to start writing on economic mobility more generally, actually, as an entry for the OCD. So this is something that I'm going to be looking at in more detail in the coming months. And absolutely, and I think migration to urban areas is very often about economic migration. So yeah, thank you.
And as you said in your paper, the migration concentrated around mines is not necessarily only miners moving around. There's a whole other host of professions that need to be present around a mine to make it function on a daily basis. So,
anywhere where there's people who might have some disposable income as well, you're going to get other people trying to make money off that.
Yeah. Gabby is asking in the chat and not in the call, what proportion of people we don't think of as migrants give their ethnos or origin, etc.?
And perhaps more interesting than just answering that question, the next four comments in the chat are actually partially a conversation around this. So we might just look at all of it.
Yes, they are starting to discuss the gladiatorial style as opposed to an ethnic. And very good, is distinguishable. So what do you think, the relationship between an actual ethnic and a fashion in this profession to denote something as?
I must admit, it's not something that I've looked at in terms of fighting styles, or you know, whether it's something that we would necessarily expect there. That's something to have a look through and see, but it's not something that I have looked at yet, I'm afraid.
I was wondering, in a sense, that the point behind the question was, is the fact that you say where you're from something you only do if you're a migrant?
No, you mainly do it if you're a migrant. So I have about 150 examples of people who do it in their own city, and I've collected those. They're on a static table and they're going to go on the website somewhere. So no, it is something that people do in their own hometown as well, for whatever reason. And I think that's the interesting thing. It's not quite clear why people do it in particular context always. So for those people, whether it's, you know, a pride in their local citizenship or some particular reason why they feel the need to do it in their local area. I have collected those four reasons of comparison as well, so we can think about why people choose to to include their origin. Sometimes we get ones where a parent has an origin and they're commemorating their child, but they haven't given the child any origin, which I think is quite interesting. So we might sometimes think of these as inherited. I think in some cases they may have been inherited, but there are clear examples where they're not. You know, they're not something that's passed on, or if they are, it's not mentioned. I do think, as I keep saying about Clunians, I don't necessarily think Clunians are moving more. I just think for some reason, Clunians are telling you that they're moving. I don't know why that might be, but.
Okay. Do we have any more questions from the call? Anyone? Okay, if we're all happy, there aren't any other questions in the chat either. So I will say again, thank you very much, Claire.
Thank you.
For speaking to us today. And a reminder to everyone that the next seminar will be in 2 weeks' time on the 7th of August. And that will be Charlotte Tupman from Exeter, again, strong Exeter presence. And she will be talking to us about reconsidering the Roman workshop, applying machine learning to the study of inscribing texts. So more epigraphy coming up in August. Thank you, everyone. See you next time.
Thank you.